Let us pray. Dear Father, what in heaven, we come into your presence now. We feel undone, we feel unworthy. Because we have not always pleased you. We have done things we shouldn't have done. We come confessing our sins and our faults before you now, Lord. Please make us what we ought to be. Take away our tendency or to sin or proneness to sin and make us worthy by your grace. Thank you, dear Lord, for this Sabbath day. Thank you for your people who have gathered together in your house to praise you and to fellowship one with the other. Thank you for providing for us the necessary things of life, food, clothing, and shelter. Thank you for bringing us together for corporate worship. Thank you, Lord, for loving us when we were unloved and unlovable. I pray that we will hear something today from your manservant that will challenge us. Dear Lord, to look at self and see where we are. Help us to redeem the time, dear Lord, redeem we are in. Not so much the time of the end, but the end of time. Help us to redeem the time, dear Lord, and know that we are on the borders of the promised land. Help that we might not be like a Israel of old, who transgressed at the borders of the promised land. May we take a lesson out of you. May we prepare to meet in peace at your soon coming, dear Lord. We remember the community of Jointwood. We remember Jamaica, land we love. Please, Lord, help that we might be channels through which people might be led to glorify you, to have a knowledge, a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, and may turn their lives around. We know that you're coming soon, dear Lord. And we want to hear from your lips, well done, good and faithful servant. But if we have not done well, Lord, you will not be able to say this to us. I pray for the one who shall speak your word. Lord, please put your words in his mind. Please be with his lips. May he say only what you want him to hear. And dear Lord, at the end of the talk, may we be satisfied. May we be able to say what's good for us to have been in your house today. Bless your people today, Lord. May we go home with the blessing that we came for. May we claim it. In the name of Jesus we ask it. Amen. Amen.
It is my my pleasure, my privilege to introduce to you the speakers this morning. First of all, the true speaker is the Holy Spirit. God the Holy Spirit is here to minister to us this morning. And it behoves us to listen when the Spirit speaks. His mouthpiece will be none other than Brother Carson Wallace.
Amen.
Brother Carson is Carson. I hope I'm pronouncing your name properly. Carson is the son of Brother Lester Wallace. Anybody know Lester Wallace?
Yes, sir.
Anybody know Sky? Brother Sky and Sister Thelma.
Yes. Amen.
We are happy to have them here with us this morning as well. And also Sister Lisa and her husband.
Amen.
And children.
Amen.
We are very happy to have you with us, and we pray that you will share with us the rich blessings that we are just about, that we are enjoying here today. We recognize that we are living in serious times, very, very serious times, so serious that what you see today, you may not see tomorrow, but of course you're going to see something much more intense tomorrow and as the days go by. Time moves quickly these days. The events of time moves rapidly these days. We have to have our eyes wide open. It's like you're in the busy streets. Cars are approaching you from every side. These are the times that we're living in. And so as the Holy Spirit speaks to Brother Wallace this morning, we pray that you'll give a listening ear, not just a listening ear, but make your hearts available to receive the words, and that the words will do good in us. Amen. Brother Wallace is a member of the Mount Edgecombe Seventh-day Adventist Church in Runaway Bay, and he works at Heart NTA in Runaway Bay. It's my prayer that we will leave here not just the way we came here this morning, but we will leave here on a new and fresh outlook on life. Our spiritual lives will make quite a leap this morning as we listen to God's word, as we digest them, as we purpose in our hearts to make them a part of our lives and be changed for the better. Before Brother Carson comes, we will now listen to a message in song from our church choir.
I got a call from an old friend. We laughed about how we have changed. As I could just tell, things weren't going as well as he claimed. He tried to hide his feelings, but they only gave him away. The longer I listened, the more I kept wishing I knew the right words to say. For more than an hour, and I smiled when he mentioned your name. I said that I knew you and told him the difference you'd make. He never thought he would need you, but maybe he's changing his mind. As we said goodbye, Lord, I told him that I had found something he'd like to find. Can you reach my friend? You're the only one who cares. You love him. Make him understand. Can you reach my friend? Help him give
Canaan. I don't know if it was an oversight or what, but somehow they ran out of wine. And so, by providence, they enjoyed the best wine for the last. I forgot totally to introduce Brother Carson's wife. Her name is Amanda. Very beautiful name, very befitting of a very beautiful lady. And I hope she will forgive me for forgetting to introduce her in the beginning, but it's a pleasure to have you here, my dear. And the best wine has been saved for the last.
I want to extend greetings to everyone here at the Seventh Adventist Church in Jointwood. I want to say happy Sabbath. I want to officially start off by saying that we are at war. The devil, Satan himself, incites hatred against God's people through the mediums of evil men. And as we watch television nowadays, if you are watching television, you will see that the signs are telling that the time is at hand. When we look at the scripture, not entirely encapsulated within what was just read, but when you read the book of Revelation, the book that reveals the time of the end, what is to come, what is to be expected, and how ready we are to be, we have to pray and fast for the Holy Spirit to come and envelop our minds that the devil will not have any chance with us.
Amen.
I hear someone making comments towards Ellen G. White's writings. The spirit of prophecy, the testimonies, the pen of inspiration, what God gives us to us as the gift of prophecy. And I hear Ellen G. White prophesying that the final deception of Satan is to make of none effect the word of God and the spirit of prophecy, to conquer and throw down the doctrines of the Seventh Adventist Church, this remnant church that will go forth to proclaim the everlasting gospel to the world. We are on training ground today. We are doing another phase of training in preparation for preaching the everlasting gospel to those in Jointwood, Eldersley, and Jamaica at large. The devil uses several tools to his advantage, and you have to pay very close attention when you go home and when you're in your workspace. You will see that the devil uses three main tools to target Bible-believing Christians, those who practice and profess this faith. He uses three main things: forgetfulness, doubt, and ignorance. Forgetfulness, doubt, and ignorance. To conquer those who are striving to serve the Master. In heaven, it started with the origin of evil. Satan himself exalted himself above God. He wanted to stand or sit in the place of God. He wanted to claim the prerogatives of God. He wanted the position of the Creator. A child wants your position as the parent. That child wants to usurp your authority. The doctrines of devils are perpetuated right throughout history, and you can see it when the devil started in heaven with the origin of evil. So the very final deception of Satan is now in full effect. To make of none effect, to discredit the word of God. And if you don't have the word of God, you're lost. You don't know where it came from, and you don't know where you're going. And so a man that I saw last month just jumped off a skyscraper building for no apparent reason, and he fell to his demise. He was suicidal. He gave up on life. He was asking the question, if the brilliant minds of this world, the ones who taught me in college, tells me that I have no value. I came from this evolution, this Big Bang. There was no intention, I just came, and I was born into this world without any hope, without any direction of where I'm going. And the end of the matter is, when I die, that's it. But I'm suffering right now. I'm suffering mentally, psychologically, and socially. My friends have left me, and my finances have collapsed. The only thing I can do is to make a quick escape and kill myself. So the devil has told a lie, and many people are believing the lies when they watch television, when they listen to men on the radio, Mota Baruka, denouncing the very authority of the Word of God that gives us true inspiration, that says, thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not commit adultery. The question was asked to Mota Baruka, Mota, what is evil? Mota says, there is nothing called evil, it's just that a man thinks is evil. So I would say to Mota Baruka, if I had the chance on radio, Mota, so if I kill you tonight, what do you consider that to be? The wise men of this world, the Bible says, professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. Sin is the real object of our discourse. Sin. Mota Baruka wants to have 5 wives. Mota Baruka wants to spend his money the way he wants. And this is, again, he is the benchmark for the Jamaican atheist, I believe. He wants to speak all manner of evil, to entertain people, and to elevate himself above God. So he denounced that the Bible cannot be real. Now if you understand what I'm simply saying is, if you have something called sin, many of what we call fun will have to go. Now if you cherish that fun, which is iniquity, cherishing sins, you will automatically be at war with the Bible, with the Word of God, because that is what it is. We don't say the Bible just another book. We say it is the divine inspiration of men who God used to speak to those people of old and is using today. I want to start off by saying that there is a theme of a Seventh-day Adventist church. Now whenever, whoever decides to change that theme, just know that the devil has taken hold of a Seventh-day Adventist church. The Bible says that in the last days, what you will know that you're in the last days is great apostasy.
Yes.
Now whenever you see great apostasy, whenever you see someone stand in this pulpit here in Jointwood and tell you something that sounds contrary to the Bible, you know that you're living in the time of the end.
Yes.
When you die, that's when the time of the end is. But there is a time that will come. 2 Timothy chapter 3 verse 1. This know also that in the last days, perilous times shall come. It's a matter of certainty. But no one knows the day nor the hour which the Son of Man cometh. But I know that his time could have come a long time ago. If like the Israelites out in the wilderness for 40 years, that should have taken 40 days, they should have turned from their evil ways, like Lot's wife, wanting to go back into Egypt, wanting to go back into sin, wanting to go back into Sodom and Gomorrah, cherishing sinfulness. The Seventh-day Adventist Church today and its members on a whole must be awakened.
Amen.
The prophet Elijah shall come. A man will come in the spirit and power of Elijah. A movement will come in the spirit and power of Elijah. And will turn back the hearts of the sons and daughters to their father, God. And to turn God's heart back to them. Because the Bible says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray, and will turn from their evil ways, I will hear from heaven and heal their land. Noah was the man who was given the message, the everlasting gospel, to go and preach to that antediluvian world in those days. But the people heeded not the call. Now I use this as the platform of the sermon, because what is coming will reflect the exact thing that happened in the days of Noah and the flood, when men heard the gospel and rejected it. The people of old had the testimony. The testimony, the spirit of prophecy then would be Noah preaching that something is going to happen. Now if Elder Patrickson, a well-revered person in the community, decided to get up one day and go out in Jointwood Square and took 1 week to say that something is going to happen, and it did happen, and then the next week he preaches this similar doctrine and says something is going to happen, what would a common sense person do? What would a person with much logic do? What would they do? Would they ignore that cry to say that something is going to happen when they have already witnessed? So the Bible has prophesied, and we have seen those prophecies come into pass. So if the Bible says this next is to come, are we to ignore them?
Sir.
Like those people who ignored gospel that Noah preached. Noah said, listen, my dear brethren, you have seen me, you have heard me, but this time God has given me a gospel that this world will be destroyed because of the sinfulness.
Yes.
The people mocked, probably some of them even helped him lift the ark. But the point is, when they saw those animals coming out of the woods, being led into the ark, that was the final straw.
Yes.
When we see homosexual marriage,
yes, sir,
being legalized, and men telling you that the real terrorists are Christians who believe in a radical book called the Bible, who believe in Jesus Christ, the one who they say they don't know if he really existed. Can you believe that on one day, the entire world, these same atheists are going to say that there is a God?
Yes.
Now, why is this so? Because the devil has cultivated the masterpiece of deception. And if you are careful to look at the Bible, you will see that your life will not be dictating my life or my wife's life or any of the elders. What you will see is that when you die, you will have to give an account for your life.
Yes.
And everyone who stands today, I see many people who, again, they're growing together as this mass of people, whether in Montego Bay, New York City, and they're coming together with this amount of evil. Everyone is trying to outdo everyone with evil. The devil is working overtime, and he knows exactly how human minds work. He has had over 6,000 years of practice on Solomon. He even tried on Jesus Christ some of the tricks that he cultivated from Adam and Eve and from the angels in heaven when he told the lie that, listen, God does not want us to be happy. God wants to sit in control of us. And rightly so. Because if a parent has a child, that parent is in control of that child.
Yes.
Now, if your creator says, thou shalt not, and you think that something is wrong with that, and you decide that you're going to break the course, the law of the land, there has to be some consequences.
Yes.
Jesus Christ, as Michael the Archangel, was challenged by Lucifer when God himself says, bow down and worship my son. Lucifer said, I am just as powerful and mighty. And I think that Christ is below me. You know, men in this world today are saying the same thing.
Yes.
I hear Pope Francis, 2015, there was a release from the Vatican News that the Pope says the account of Genesis is not accurate. Making of none effect the word of God, and I saw three unclean spirits coming out of the mouth of the dragon, out of the mouth of the beast, out of the mouth of the false prophets. These are devil doctrines of devils that will go forth to deceive the entire world. They are to conquer this fundamental principle of how the Bible is established, that there is a creator. In the beginning God created, and therefore we have the seventh day Sabbath. Satan himself says, if I can just make one alteration to, you shall not surely die. If I can make one alteration to the creation story, the Genesis story, I would have won the battle.
Yes.
It's a sad tale that many people right now are deceived. I would not criticize the Adventist faith. I would not criticize the fundamental beliefs if I had at any point in time decided to leave this faith. I would never criticize it. Because you have to think logically. Now, if once you believe that this church was the remnant church, the church that is working, the Spirit of God is working through this movement, if you believe that and you decide to leave this church, because the Bible says in the last days many shall depart from this faith, even these seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, if you believe that this church today, as you sit here, and you believe that you're going to heaven, that's why you're making attempts. If you knew that you were not going to make it to heaven, I think you would be out having a grand time today, Sabbath day. So your desire really is to make it to heaven, because that's the ultimate goal. Our purpose is not to be here on earth to accumulate wealth and have a house and a car. It's really when we die, we go to heaven. The most beautiful place that Ellen G. White said, when she was taking a vision and saw the New Jerusalem, a city of gold, there is no words to describe it. The Bible also confirms the corresponding thing that Ellen G. White prophesied, that it has not entered into the hearts of men what heaven will be like.
Amen.
So today, our main objective is to study, therefore, to show ourselves a proof unto God that we can be taken up with Him when He comes back.
Amen.
So we'll be studying the Word briefly, because what I have here, I think bears much relevance, and it is potent enough not to spend much time deliberating, because we have all studied the Word. It is just a reminder. That's why the Bible says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy, because it was already established. Now, all of us here have a testimony as Seventh-day Adventists. Everyone in the world today has a testimony.
Yes.
Even the 80s, when the Titanic was sinking, they were crying out to God. And when they fell over into that cold, ice, crippling water, they were crying out to God, but too late was their cry. When the flood came, they were saying, Brother Noah, save us, but probation was closed.
Yes.
I have this theory that I share with my co-workers and everyone that I go down there in St. Anne to share with the gospel, this good news that the redemption, there is redemption. So no matter how far you have gone in sin, once the messenger comes to say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand, like John the Baptist, like Jesus Christ himself. That's how he started. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand.
Yes.
You know what the world says to this same doctrine? You cannot judge me. Only God alone can judge me. Now the 12 apostles were sent out,
yes,
to preach good news to the people, not to condemn.
Okay.
But if you understand when the Bible says, thou shalt not judge, it meant thou shalt not condemn, because you don't know what a person has in their heart.
True.
So we cannot condemn. Regardless of what a person has done, we cannot condemn. But it is our objective as disciples of Christ today to tell people to repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand.
Yes.
And there are several precepts in the Bible that tells us that we must self-examine ourselves before we can preach the Word of God to the dying world. So just before the final conflict, the tribulation that is coming upon this earth, when we shall be slaughtered just for the mere fact that we profess that God is the Creator,
yes,
and we have to follow His laws.
Amen.
Just by upon our profession of our faith, we will be slaughtered. Everything that happened in the past time will happen again.
Yes.
When we read about the French Revolution, when we read about the Dark Ages, when men were slaughtered for their faith. I want to point out one thing here before I move on. The first passage of scripture said, Daniel chapter 12 verse 1, and at that time shall Michael, Jesus Christ, stand up, the great prince that standeth for his people. And there shall be a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation.
Yes.
Your grandmother dying cannot be compared. Your legs being amputated because of the dreaded disease, diabetes, cannot be compared. The World War 1 and 2 and 3, if we have one, cannot be compared. The bubonic plague that killed millions in the dark, in those time of old, cannot be compared. And if you don't know, the bubonic plague killed over 100 million people. That cannot be compared, because the Bible says, a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation. That should really stimulate some kind of awakening, not fear, but really awakening. Because if Noah knew that he was going to be saved, there was nothing to fear. But because there is this war that's fighting, the great controversy between sin and between righteousness, between the father of sin, the devil, Satan himself, and Jesus Christ, the deliverer, there is a war. And the minute that we start to think of the concepts, not so much, let me just love everyone and let me just go to church, you will fail miserably. Because you need to know, when something comes into your mind, not to say, or when something comes to your mind, not to act.
Yes.
Because we are at war, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers of darkness.
Yes.
Now, I would want to take this one opportunity to profess that I am waiting on that time to go on national TV. And I know that time will come. Not for me necessarily, but for a man of God. And he will ask a question. If you, atheists, and we want to ask this question before the Pope takes power. We want to ask this question, because when he takes power, he don't care if there is a billion people who does not believe or want to go along with it. Once he has the majority on his side, and the majority is the state,
yes,
those who have the guns. Because now, if you know about the FEMA camps that have been developed, let me share something else. They said unto Pilate, crucify him. You know what is going to happen in the last days? They're going to say, crucify us. But not only that, they're going to say, take Vibes Cartel out of prison, because the prison is going to be so crowded. Take those prisoners, those murderers, rapists out of prison and put the Adventists in there. They said, take Barabbas out of prison and put Jesus Christ to death.
Yes.
Now that typifies what is to come. And you have to understand, every time when you read the Bible, it was written for them, but also for us. It says, prove all things. So we are going to prove today all things from the Word of God.
Amen.
You know, in Daniel chapter 12, verse 10, it says, many shall be purified and made white and tried, but the wicked shall do wickedly, and none of the wicked shall understand, but the wise shall understand. Today we will pray for wisdom, that the Spirit of God will come inside of us, because regardless of what happens today, hereafter, each of us as individuals will have to be tested. Ellen G. White writes so extensively on the process of self-examination, and the process of us being tested on every point, as how Jesus Christ was tested. And we, as Seventh-day Adventist believers today, if we are part of the 144,000 or the great multitude, we shall be tested on every point that we have, every sin that we have ever committed will come back at us, and we'll have to overcome those sins for us to be made white.
Yes.
Let us bow our heads as we will pray for the Holy Spirit to cleanse our hearts from envy, hatred, malice, and covetousness. Let us pray. Dear kind and heavenly Father, we bow before you once again, Father, to call upon your name, because in your name there is life. We pray today, Father, for the Holy Spirit to descend upon us, Father, that we may find true revival and reformation before the time of the end comes.
Amen.
We pray, Father, today that Jointwood here will be inspired after all of us as members will go forth to share, not just this week, but for the remainder of the time that we find peace. I pray, Father, that as the storm approaches, we here in this building today, Father, will our lives will be changed. And I pray that you may send those messengers of peace, hope, and love to remind us of our sole purpose or objective, which is to serve God and give glory to Him. For the hour of His judgment has come. I pray, Father, that today our prayers will be answered. We humbly ask in Jesus' name.
Amen.
What I really want to share with you is present truth, because you know I'm going to share something regarding my father. I remember having a conversation with my father about having this great passion and zeal for speaking really casually to my friends about the everlasting gospel, because it is not when we take the pulpit or put on a tie that some of these people are going to listen to us, but when the conversations in school, at our workplace, and in the communities, when persons are taking control of that conversation, there is no conversation that a semi-Adventist should not be in control of. The fact of the matter is, it might sound a bit radical, but there is no time to lose. And when I see men, young men and old men, following after the world, I am saying, wow, we are deceived. They follow after the world when they watch the entertainment of the world. The world is having a heyday while the message of God is being suppressed. There is an attack on the word of God from every side. In our homes, our family members, the devil is using every means necessary. He does not care if we go to church on Sabbath. Because the Bible says that many who have not know guard their minds from the wiles of Satan. They have not invested in prayer and fasting. Remember when the 12 disciples were trying to cast out a demon?
Yes.
And they asked Christ, how is it that we cannot cast out demons? You're trying to pray, fast, and you go to work. And that very same moment, in that very same week or month, when you probably were inspired by the Spirit, something happened and you were inspired, that's the time when everyone comes to work to attack you. It's the devil.
Yes.
In them. Now, if I ask Muta Baruka the same question, why is it Muta that we have, let us say, paranormal activities? If there is no God, if the scientists say that there is no God, why is it that we had those people, not just the other workers, but the Fox sisters in New York City, that they apparently all of those people who went down to listen to are here from the Fox sisters, and you can go and research them. They had this ability, it is said, because I research it both ways. Listen to what the world had to say, and then listen to what religious men who believed in the word of God had to say about these people. And it is said that by the world, because this is what the world is doing right now. They're trying to say that there's no such thing called Satan. And then it goes back to say the greatest trick that Satan has ever pulled on men is to say that there's no devil.
Yes.
So whatever you would do, it is not inspired by any external force or spiritual being. It is just your thought.
Yes.
Whatever you do is not wrong. Whatever, if you want to live your life today having 10 wives, is not wrong. And I say, then why do we believe in God? I am simply saying, if there is a God, why not serve Him?
Amen.
If there is a God, why refute the claims of the Bible?
Yes.
So many of those who are preaching the prosperity gospel today, they are saying, listen, we don't have to worry about doctrines, just love. And you know that there is a scripture that speaks directly about that same doctrine of the devil. Now, if the Bible says, study therefore to show thyself approved unto God. The Bible says, I've always shared this with my worldly friends. I've always said to them, if the righteous is scarcely saved, what says the ungodly?
Yes.
And how can we looking back at Sodom and Gomorrah, when I always point to them that there are several things that God did. Everything else, but you see right now, when a man takes a 38 caliber gun and shoots a man in the head, it's the devil. But everything else was the devil. What you see, what you can point to that God did was raining down fire and brimstone on Sodom and Gomorrah.
Yes.
The flood. If there's anything else that you can point to that God did that would be against humanity, would be the destruction of sin.
Yes.
Because sin does not exist by itself. It has to consume a body. It is not something roaming in the atmosphere that we inhale. So to destroy sin, God ultimately will have to destroy people.
Yes.
If they are clinged to sin.
Amen.
And I said to them when I heard Vice Cartel said some stuff. I heard people talking about it, and I had to go. I'm not going to repeat what he said, but I had to go and denounce those claims because people are being deceived right now.
Yes.
They have deceived themselves into believing that you don't really have to obey the laws of the land, the laws of the Word of God, and now they are deceiving others. Because that's what Vice Cartel has done. He has told himself that I have no obligation whatsoever. If I want to go to hell, if there's such a thing, let it be. It's not all of us meant to go to heaven. No, the Bible says that in the very last, when God himself shall come and sit on that throne, all knees shall bow and confess. There shall be weeping, wailing, and gnashing of teeth. Now, it's not hard to stop sinning. You must be convicted and then you're converted. You must recognize that there's something diabolically wrong with how mankind right now is pursuing the course of success.
True.
Success is not limited to a certain achievement, because a man who accomplishes his goal of owning a home says that he's successful in that right. And then the man says that I'm not successful because I've not been the president of the United States. So what is our success? That's the question. What is our objective, ultimate goal? What is success? Our Bible that we have right now gives us the answer to that. There are several points that I would like to point out. The first one is, the question is, what is the purpose, the main purpose for a man here on earth? And I gave the answer to that. It is to serve God and keep His commandments.
Yes.
Now, if that is the only thing that we must really put as priority, we need to ask ourselves, this is a self-examination process. Are we serving God and keeping His commandments? When we go home tonight, are we praying earnestly? Because I read something last week, that a time will come when not my father or my mother will be praying for me if they are still alive. The time will come when no external prayer, can deliver you from catastrophe. The Bible talks about Jacob's time of trouble.
Yes.
His father could not pray for him.
True.
Jacob was on his own at that point.
Amen.
Now, for anyone who is a bit lost as to what I'm developing here with the Jacob's time of trouble, the time will come when you shall see. It can be 2016, February. It can be 2016 February, and I'm also using that random date. Just like what happened in Baltimore. Who here saw what happened in Baltimore? The riots. Can you raise your hand, all of you saw what happened in Baltimore? Okay. What happened in Baltimore is just a smokescreen of what is coming. Can you imagine all of these guys in Jointwood and Eldersley, when for a cause, something starts to happen, and the state says, we need to get these terrorists out of this world. We need to eliminate people who are causing crisis and calamity. We don't need the police to kill these people. Just any one of these people that you find, kill them. Even your very own shall betray you. Now, if at any point in time a reward is granted unto them, that will even spice up the deal. But the devil, the Bible says, and L.A.G. one says that a time will come when probation shall close, and Jesus Christ himself shall take off his heavenly robe, and at that time all human probation will close. You know, the devil has been inciting this doubt in my mind. I wonder if my probation is closed. Out of nowhere, I'm talking about this week, because I'm praying and the devil is blocking my prayers. I'm praying and there are so many things coming in my mind, and I'm saying I'm at war, like Jacob, time of trouble. That will be intensified and even become physical.
Yes.
You will feel real hunger. You will feel real starvation. Now, the devil is using all means necessary. I'm talking about the destruction here, folks. I'm talking about the television that you're watching. If you probably don't recognize some of these subliminal messages which are being passed through these television programs, if you don't turn it off same time, you will be deceived.
Yes.
Because I'm telling you, what if by this September, those who are now in the Seventh Adventist Church, by this September, their probation are closed. What will happen to you? You shall be coming to church same way. Ellen G. White writes about this. She said that she was shown that when the Spirit of God shall leave all of those who are unsealed, because we're going to be talking about the great shaking, those who are now being sealed, the 144,000, they're the first fruits. They will be sealed first, and then thereafter, a great work will be done, and the great multitude will be brought in as the harvest. So we're planting a seed right now. Each time when you go out into the community and you really not just say God is good casually to someone, but you really take them by the hand, if that person is your true friend, or even if you consider that person to be an enemy, and you tell them something, the most sincere thing,
yes,
that probation, when you die tonight, we have seen many people dying in sin, when you die tonight, no life, no 25 years or 45 years that you live on earth can be compared to just the everlasting life that you will have in heaven. But greater than that, if there is something to fear, the Bible talks about any man who receives the mark of the beast.
Yes.
It would have, anyone who receives the mark of the beast, it would have been better if they were not born.
True.
Anyone who, like Judas, betrays Christ. When you sit here today and if you listen to any message that comes from the pulpit, it would have been better for those people in Sodom and Gomorrah if you are lost, hearing the Spirit of God speaking for 25 years from this pulpit. It would have been better if you were living. It would have been better for those people in Sodom and Gomorrah. It would be better for them than for you. When the time of the end comes, and fire and brimstone shall descend and shall kill the wicked, shall destroy them, every sin that they have ever committed will come back to them. And that's why Ellen G. White says that she saw some of the wicked burning up within like probably days or so forth. Some burned for probably months. Who knows? Whatever sin that you have ever committed. So the longer life you live, if you go to hell, the longer you will burn. Technically, when you look at the whole theory. So if you live at 65 and you don't make it into the kingdom of heaven, there's something to fear. One, you'd have missed out on what was free. The New Jerusalem. Everlasting life. Asking God the most desired questions that you know, seek to answer, to have answers to. You'd have missed out on all of that. But greater than that, you shall be destroyed into the lake of fire.
Yes.
Now, of recently, 2014, 2015, if you guys did not see, there were many volcanic eruptions happening around the world. Now, Satan himself knows that this lava that he sees is the same thing that is going to destroy him, because God is going to bound him and take away the power that he can flee from this earth or from to evade destruction. God is going to strip him of that power at that point, and he's going to burn.
Yes.
Now, he knows of this destruction that is coming upon him, and he sees, I don't know if he's the one doing this volcanic eruptions around the world, but if he sees this, he says, whoa, this is a reminder that I don't have long. When he saw the flood, you guys must read the books of Ellen G. White, the pen of inspiration, the gift to us, because it is not limited to Ellen G. White. It is because she availed herself to be used. But she says that when Satan saw the flood, that was the first time in the entire creation of Satan that he said, my days are not long.
Yes. Amen.
Now, if he knows, then what say we when we have the word of God here?
Amen.
So, I have a document here that I've created, and anyone that wants one can get one at the end of the sermon. Now, this outlines clearly the true purpose of man. It speaks of the ultimate purpose for man. It speaks of the law of God, how sin started. Jesus Christ, who is he and what does he serve in our existence? It speaks of the distractions that are now here and which are greater to come. It speaks of the seal of God, which the seal of God will come before the mark of the beast. The Bible says, start at my temple. So all of us who are here, the time will come when you see the earthquakes, the cases have already been decided. Whether you are sealed or you are condemned. It says that, let him who is righteous be righteous still. Let him who is filthy be filthy still. And my friends, believe it or not, before the Sunday law is passed, because when the Sunday law is passed, it is for the world.
Yes.
But before the Sunday law is passed, all of those who are in the church, as by Ellen G. White said that when she saw the percentage of those, it was a little number. Everyone was on this train bound for perdition. Those who probably had even those slight sins that they were cherishing in their minds were on that train. So the purification of those who are the 144,000, who she saw being sealed before the time of trouble came. She saw this little number when the angel said, look a little higher. But she saw the train, and almost all the world was on the train. So the time will come when all of us here, probably it's five of those who are in the church, I pray to God that all of us here will make that right decision.
Amen.
But the time will come when Jointwood here, 1 month, you're going to see some stuff happening. I'm talking about before the end of this year. I am not going to say much on that because that's my personal conviction. The Holy Spirit has been revealing some stuff to me. I'm not going to share it because I'm not a prophet. But the time will come this year, when you're going to ask yourself, am I right with God? The answer can be given if you choose to find the truth.
Yes.
The answer is, let me know, stand up as a man of God, because the Bible says that God is searching for a man to stand. Ezekiel chapter 33 verse 22, I believe. And I sought for a man to stand and I found none.
Yes.
Now, if Ellen G. White also corroborates that story by saying, not one in 20 already.
Yes.
Not one in 20 already. It's just a pity that I don't have the quotation for you. Go and read it for yourself. It's really startling. It's like telling you now that by October, the Sunday law is going to pass. You're going to say, that is impossible. That is not what I'm alluding to. I'm just making something as a point. Now, if by October, the Sunday law is going to be passed, and many of us are not ready, how easy will it be when they say, go out into the grassroots and bear cold and winter? How much can you go without eating for a day, or for a week, or for 2 weeks? So when I'm saying this, is to really charge us, to evoke this sense of the nearness of the time. Because I'm telling you, friends, it is not a sermon that is going to change our lives. It's not one particular experience that will change it. It's a lifestyle. Ellen G. White writes, go in Google and type, transfer of character. No, change of character, not transferable. A character cannot be changed overnight. It's a lifestyle that you develop over time.
Amen.
It's not easy for me to have been drinking for 25 years and get up one day and say, I'm going to stop drinking. It can be done, though, if you develop your mind towards the heed of the calling of the Spirit of God.
Amen.
Because you know what changed my life? I was living as an average Sydney Adventist. I was down here in Runaway Bay, and there are about 5 to 6 things that happened to me that claimed my life. And in the midst of the moments, I believed and God delivered.
Amen.
I say this prayer, Father, you recognize how much of my friends have not heard this gospel. The text was revealed to me, when this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached throughout all the world for a witness, then shall the end come. How close are we to the end? Immediately, when something reveals to everyone that this, that we are preaching from the pulpit, Revelation chapter 14, 6 to 12, when we look at that scripture, the theme of the seven Adventist is faith, we can clearly see that when this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached out all the world for a witness, then shall the end come. Once they read the three angels' messages, it takes 1 week. Then we're going to see all hell turn break loose. These people are going to reject it. Many of these people, it is not my word. The word of God has already outlined to us that many people are going to accept the mark of the beast out of fear. Because like the Jesuits who of olden days took the heads of young babies, your firstborn, and smashed them against the walls and asked you, are you still believing in the Seventh-day Adventist faith with a smirk on your face? You are going to really see what time you are living in. The Jacob time of troubles. And no one else can save you because it's going to be a play on mind. The devil is... There is something that was revealed this week. The devil has archived all of your files. So when he starts to turn up the pressure, he's not turning up pressure on you right now because he does not want revival and reformation. But when trouble comes, Ellen G. White says that if trouble should descend upon us, no. There should be real revival and reformation. So the devil wants us to have a warm time, you know, the Laodicean lifestyle. We have increasing wealth of knowledge and think when a pastor comes to preach present truth, we have no need. Don't worry about that. That is whatever. But the Bible says that perilous times will come. Yes. And no pastor up here for himself can preach to you when that time comes. True. Because there shall be a famine in the land.
Yes.
So by October of this year, the real date is September 22nd to September 28th. The Pope, the man of sin, who says that he is above the authority of the Bible, says that, listen to me. Jesus Christ himself is just a man. Jesus Christ, the doctrine is from the papacy. Jesus Christ himself had children with Mary Magdalene and saying all manner of things. I'm telling you, when I went and I read it from the Vatican News, I said to myself, my people are destroyed because of lack of knowledge. They should awaken. All of us, as Christians, we really should be calling on all the radio programs, calling the television set, and just when they're talking about something else, we're just throwing this one. How is it that the Pope is saying this and no one is, no matter what the topic of Live at 7 is, I just call and say, how is it that the Pope, we just want to create some conversations here, because Ellen G. White says, are we to wait until the crisis comes for us to start preaching this gospel to the world? She says that this gospel will be preached in the hardest time when we don't have social media, we don't have telephones, we have no internet, and we have to really be going from door to doors like the men of old, literally be taken back to the hardest way, walking in the sun from here to Montego Bay, and we'll be preaching the word of God. Many will not endure, but he that endured to the end shall be saved. But like my mother and my father, they might die. Because the Bible, same Bible says that many, God will take their life because he recognizes that they're feeble. They don't have the vitality, and he's speaking about the spiritual vitality as well as a physical. So with the health message that Ellen G. White gave to us as a gift over 100 years ago, did you know that the devil himself also is making up non-effect that very health message? The devil right now has evil men in the world who are saying, let us stop eating meat. They did not get this from Ellen G. White. So know that for in the 1990s, when we weren't really pushing this agenda about the health message, now in 2015, men are saying that they are no longer eating meat, they are no longer doing this, they are no longer... So if we should go to them with Ellen G. White health message now and to say that there are many brilliant revelations that Ellen White got from God through the vision. They will say, but we don't need that because we are already living healthy. So you recognize that in every sphere, the devil has made a counterfeit.
Yes.
The devil right now has established in Runaway Bay, many of my people, they don't consider Saturday to be the seventh day.
Yes.
Now we're talking about casually here. They think because when they go to work, they sit on their roster. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. I have a coworker who personally does not, I don't know if he's illiterate, but you could look at history and see which day was the seventh day.
Yes.
Now he now says that, listen, this Sunday is the seventh day. And it is the hardest, just to pass that point, we're not even getting to the Pope and what is, I'm just talking about just the known fact that the Sunday is the first day of the week. And he says, no, Sunday is the seventh day of the week. We're not talking about gospel here now.
Yes.
I'm talking about, I'm just trying to say to him, before we can establish that there shall be a Sunday law, because Saturday is what the Bible refers to when it says, remember the seventh day to keep it holy.
Yes.
And on the first day, the evening and the morning was the first day, the evening and the morning, and what God did as the creator. But he's saying, no, the Sunday isn't, so if right now, what I'm simply saying, putting to you guys, if that right now, if there are people who are in Jamaica who are saying, they really are convinced that when they look at the phone, it says Sunday is the seventh day. When they look at the calendar, it says Sunday is the seventh day. They have already lost, because it is not then that the Pope, when he stands and says everybody should worship on Saturday, on Sabbath, because they're going to call it Sabbath.
Yes.
Everyone, because they're going to say that is what the Bible was alluding to, Sabbath. That's why I believe the devil used Hitler to try to wipe out the race of the Jews, because they're a living legend.
Yes.
They have not broken tradition. So if you really want to know which is the seventh of the week, just ask the Jews. And the Jews today profess that Saturday is the seventh day. So we don't need any confusion about which day is the Sabbath day. Even today, Hollywood says that Saturday is the seventh day because it shows Good Friday, Sabbath day, and then Sunday, God goes. But there is coming a movement that is going to change all of that. And anyone who still stands by that, persecute them.
Yes.
The Bible says that, and the devil shall make war against the remnant, those who keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus. But his testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy, which is the books of Ellen White. I want to close up by giving a personal testimony. Today is Youth Day, and I have lived a life giving much thanks to the blessings that I received. You know, being born in this rural part of Jamaica, and then going out, even still in Jamaica, but to the wider world, seeing how the devil has created this delusion right across. I remember being admitted in the hospital on several occasions. The devil sent after me to kill me. And I prayed those prayers of faith, and Christ answered. Can you ask yourself this question? If a person like yourself should be shot in the head, do you think it's coincidence to live if you should pray a prayer? Because right now the doctors, when they are in the hospital, the doctors say, it's just coincidence that you live. Even though they see church members visiting and praying, they said, oh, hush, hush, that is just coincidence that you live. They pronounce you dead enough. They said that you have terminal cancer, and you're sure to die. But when you're healed just by joining the SDA church, visiting those down in Black River, they said, okay, this is remarkable, but it is just, I'm talking about people who don't believe in God. They say, it's just coincidence. And no matter how much testimonies they have seen, because some of them, you know, have already died in car accidents. Some of these doctors and so forth, they did not get a chance to hear this everlasting gospel. But the little that God gave them for a witness, the Bible says that God winks at ignorance. But when God gives you the sure fact that he exists and you walk away from that, the question was asked to me, Carson, what about those in China who have been dying? How could there be a God? Because I hear these so-called intellectuals who have gone to the universities, even here in Jamaica, who now boast that they are atheists. They said to me, if there is such a thing called love and God, how is it that those over there in India, right now millions are dying who have not heard the word of God, what is God going to do with them? Well, I say to them, read with me the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah. Many people were in Sodom and Gomorrah, I believe, did not hear of this everlasting gospel, but they were destroyed. And it is just, because I'm not going to question God. Did you know that when Pilate said to him, what shall I do with this man, Jesus Christ? They said, crucify him, and let his sin be on us and our children. If I have a child tomorrow and that child dies at the age of one, what will happen? That's the question that they're really asking me. How could God destroy China feel 90% are Buddhist.
Yes.
How could God destroy these people? How are these people dying in sin? They have not gotten a chance. And I said, God wins at ignorance. But God destroys Sodom and Gomorrah with 12-year-olds. Over 2 million probably said people were in Sodom and Gomorrah. They were destroyed. Children, both young and old, were destroyed. The time will come when God shall get up out of his, out of the most holy place.
Yes.
And that's why the Bible says, in the sanctuary, thy ways, O Lord, are in the sanctuary. So we can know.
Yes.
From the start of this movement, 1844, to now, when God is just holding on by the straw. And bit of information that I must share with you guys. I think in September, they're planning on releasing a movie depicting Jesus Christ and his 12 disciples as homosexuals, practicing homosexuals, showing Jesus Christ kissing the 12 disciples. The first time I heard it, it blew my mind. I didn't even want to think about it. A co-worker at my workplace came to me and said to me, what do I think about the legalization of gay marriage when they were showing the same symbol that shows a covenant between God and man to say God will never destroy the earth again with flood but with fire. Satan himself just said, let me give this inspiration to this man over here. It might not have been Charles Darwin who he gave the inspiration to deceive a large majority of people, but he gave someone the inspiration to use the rainbow as representation of abomination. And he has made of none effect the rainbow, the significance of the rainbow. So the first time when a man sees the rainbow, now he forgets about the flood. He forgets about, and he remembers, and he sees Sodom and Gomorrah being elevated in our present generation. This know also that in the last days, perilous times shall come. Now, there are doubts to what I'm saying to you. It's the devil. Anyone who is doubting what I'm saying to you right now about what the agenda is for September, because the Pope is going to address the world leaders and he's going to say to them three things. And he released in his encyclical letter. So it's no hidden secret, it's no conspiracy theory, it is not me saying something that is not known. His main objective really is to focus on getting back to God. Under the broad umbrella of those things. He says that we need to really cool down on our work time, on our play time. We need to get back to God. And you know, they are the ones who really cause the wide class of the world right now to be watching Hollywood and the deception of thinking that you can live any lifestyle. They're the ones who allow the music of the world to be playing right now and we don't ban them. But the least time when a man like Pastor Glenn Samuels, God bless him, on the Sunday morning says it is an abomination. This is the final phase, friends, if you didn't know. This is the final phase of free speech. Final phase. Because when this encyclical is brought to the UN, they will say, listen, we need to shut down the troublemakers. These people are preaching hate because they are just as evil as the terrorists. And the whole theory of it is, you know, Islam is what the devil uses right now to incite war and to bring about legislations. Because he uses Islam to bring about these chaotic events, and then he will use the leaders to bring about the reforms, how best. And they will say, once they have conquered, once they have suppressed free speech, they will say peace and safety. Now we can sleep without hearing sin being called by its right name. They will say peace and safety. It's not talking about men killing men, and it's not talking about that. When they have suppressed religious freedom and they elevate the Roman Catholic doctrine, because that is what 2 Thessalonians 2 verse 3 to 4 says, you will know that a man will come who will profess himself above the authority of the word of God, and he will speak great things against the word of God. That is what the focus of the message is, and that is what the theme of the Seventh Adventist Church says in Revelation chapter 14. So here on out, what is the new movement for us? How do we combat this crisis, you start in your home. You start with personal devotion. Because I'm telling you, friends, there is not a messenger that is going to come to convict you if you are not convicted by yourself.
Amen.
No message can be preached from the pulpit if you're not willing to give up sin.
True.
Because that is the real reason why I'm preaching from the pulpit today. We're preaching that there is something called sin, and the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God, Jesus Christ, that He offers to us, you don't have to die for the sins that you have committed. He says you don't have to die with the angels and Satan, because the Bible says the lake of fire was created only for Satan and his angels and thereafter anyone who joined in rebellion, open rebellion against the word of God. So many are going to be lost. Don't let it be any one of us in here. Because again, the devil works with forgetfulness. He forgot what his position was. He was a created being, and God was the creator. He forgot. And then he doubted when he forgot. He doubted and said, I think I can usurp the power and the authority of God. He doubted in the word of God. He said that we're not sure that what God is giving us is the real story. Let us form an alliance against God. Let us conquer God. You know, you cannot read that in Isaiah, I believe, when he said that he saw himself, he said, I will ascend. And he was using the I word, Isaiah. He said, I will ascend, I will sit in the place of the Most God, of the Most High. Same thing that he is telling the Pope to do right now. And he's telling you to do it. When you say, what I'm saying right now is irrelevant. We don't need to hear this. But tonight, we can go to a dead yard and stay for 10 hours.
Yes.
And we consider that we are going to be saved into the kingdom of heaven just by easy gospel. I'm telling you, friends, if you should get a vision like Ellen G. White, she said that she had to tell God to stop the vision when she saw the time of the end. She said to God, stop the vision. And I think that's the only vision that she has ever really pointed out that she said that she wanted to. She could not bear it when she saw men's skin being stripped off their body for persecution. Because this time around, they have developed new mode of techniques of torture. Remember, doctors know how delicate the nervous systems are. Now, they don't have to go through much like those days when they chop off your head and chop off your hands and so forth. They can incite the craziest amount of pain. Just by you, they're catching you and just putting you in some torture chamber. And they're going to have a meal of it. That's why I really don't watch cricket and football and so forth, because there is no time left. And those same stadiums are going to be used as modes of entertainment. Like Coliseum, when people are being slaughtered. You know that there are movies right now who are training the mind. Movies and video games, training the mind of young kids how to shoot, kill, and slaughter, how to be snipers. No, that does not go away. Nothing that you have ever learned. Ben Carson says that everything that you have ever learned stays with you. No, only the Spirit can override that if you have the Spirit of God in you. But Ellen White says that when the probation of all of these worldlings are closed, even my mother, if she is ungodly, she's going to be like the witch.
Yes.
I'm telling you, when the devil takes hold of these people in the last days, when the Spirit of God right now is keeping us here in church. Because the nature of man, we are born in sin and shaping iniquity. So it has to take effort to be a Christian.
Amen.
So there is no such thing as prosperity gospel, just love, and that will solve itself. It says, study therefore to show thyself approved. Now, this, all of that I've said really, is nothing new. All of the 144,000 will be united in this same truth.
Yes.
And it is those who have studied, who have shown themselves that they have been approved and worthy enough, because you cannot preach to someone if you don't know. If you don't know the word of God, you have to know it on every subject matter. So if it is a sanctuary message, if it is the health, that you have to know everything. Because when you're called before the judges, I was in the courts the other day, and I found myself standing before the judge. And the Holy Spirit, because everything that happens reflects to me a spiritual corresponding thing as to what is coming. And I was in the courtroom, and the judge says, what say you, Mr. Wallace, guilty innocent or guilty, and I pleaded guilty. It's the same way that we are going to plead guilty. We are going to confess our sins before God.
Yes.
We're going to confess our sins before God today, and we're going to say we are guilty. But there is hope through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
On to close off by giving my personal testimony. Here's this one testimony that I want to give. I was out snorkeling one time with a friend, with some friends. Rochelle was there. I was out diving. And this was the 24th of December, that would have been for the world Christmas Eve. I was out diving with a group of friends at a public beach. And the devil, I'm telling you guys, you don't know until the devil sends death your way. The devil sends a boat and hit me right in the head. The propeller scraped my hand, like it was a speedboat. So based on how fast the boat came upon me, that's why the propeller did not cut me up like I heard of an incident that happened over there in Negril, and tourists were chopped to death by the propeller of the boat. So the boat came, hit me in the head, that was sure death. It was a speedboat, that one, the ones that boom boom, those ones.
Yes.
Hit me in the head, my head should have exploded. The pain that I felt at that point, I've never felt any pain like that in my entire life, and I wish I don't. The pain literally crippled my body, so I couldn't swim, but I know that I was conscious, and I was sinking out because where I was in the water, I couldn't stand. I was like about 5 feet above the seabed. So when the boat hit me in the head, my friend was pushed away from me because the boat came, swerved out of him, and hit me right in the head. And I saw myself dying. It's like I was going to die, and I said, Father, please don't let me die here, I'm not ready. I did not think about anything else. Please don't let me die here, I'm not ready. And I was sinking. Half an hour after, I was in the hospital. I was hospitalized, and I was crying for joy. I was preaching in the hospital. I was preaching to the doctor. I was preaching to patients who were around me. And coincidentally, those patients that were around me died. Four of them died in the hospital that same night. I was admitted in the hospital, and I was left to die. Satan himself was in the hospital that night, trying to incite all kind of doubt in my mind. You're going to die tonight. You're not worthy enough. You're going to die tonight. I did not know where this thing came from. It was a demon. I was in the hospital that night. So I should have died, but I lived to tell this story. My testimony is just to inspire you. Don't let that death comes before you think that you are ready. Because whenever you think that you are ready, the Bible says that let him who think that he take heed, lest he falls. So that same friend that I was snapping with 3 years after he died. And I say this like that was his 3 years of probation. He wasn't a Christian. But I was always urging him, come to church with me, my brethren. Come to church with me. He was a very good friend. But he did not want to really hear the gospel. Just casually, we'll go to heaven, save you. Because they think that, you know, I'm not doing nothing evil. So his life ended just by I getting a call to say that he was hospitalized. And then I heard that he died in the hospital. They found him on the bed Sunday morning, dead. Stiff tone, dead. And the only thing that happened, he was like 26. No. The only thing that happened to him really was that when they did the autopsy, they recognized that he had leukemia. They gave him, I think, some bags of blood, but he did not survive. He was a strong, healthy person. And it has shocked everyone who knew him. How could this person just have leukemia and die? But his probation closed.
Yes.
He failed to recognize that what happened to me and the testimonies that I immediately gave when I was in the hospital, immediately gave years after I've been giving those testimonies, telling people, listen man, that was no accident. I was bound to die there. The very act of the boat hitting me in my head. I'm talking about like, it would be like a fallout of an airplane and drop right on my neck. And if I get up and walk, you guys would probably clap and laugh. But it was a sure thing. I was born to die and I live to tell this tale.
Yes,
there is more to be done in Jointwood and in the world. There is more that is coming. That was just my little episode of physical torture that the devil tried to bring upon me, tried to wear out my patience in believing in God. But there is more to come, greater than that.
Yes.
I might live to see my mother and my father dying. That will take a toll. I might live to see many people being slaughtered mercilessly. I'm not talking about even gunmen, I'm talking about when persecution comes. How are we going to cope if we cannot even overcome sin now?
Amen.
We have freedom to go and pray. The time will come when, like Daniel and the three Hebrew boys, we shall be brought up in front of people to say, what say you? Either we will, like the three Hebrew boys, profess that we will not bow, or like some others. Remember, there were Hebrews down in Babylon and they all bowed and they were worshipping false God, Satan himself. Because once you don't worship God, you're worshipping Satan by whatever means that he establishes, whether it was a physical image or the image of the beast in the last days. But friends, I close by saying to you, listen, this is a charge. There's no more time left. There's no time to rest. Because when September comes, the 22nd of September, really go and look at it and look at what the Pope is promoting. Look at what the Pope is suggesting. Immediately after, they themselves are going to bring up about a financial crisis. And they're going to say, we have the answer. If everyone should do what we say, this is the same thing that they're saying. I hear them saying, if my people are called by my name. Pope is saying, listen, if people are to turn back to the word of God the way we say it, then there shall be no ISIS, there shall be no need, if we just unite.
Yes.
And the only church that is not going to want to unite is going to be seen as the troublemakers.
True.
The Jesuit, the oath of the Jesuit, who these are the brainchild behind everything, where we cannot convince, we will confuse. So they have infiltrated every entity in the world. Where we cannot convince, we'll confuse. That's the mantra. And the end justifies the means. No, nothing that they do is considered bad in their sight once it is done in the name of what their belief system is. It's more like considered meritorious. They will clap and keep church when they assassinate Dr. Ben Carson if he runs for president. Because he will bring about something, they will investigate. The world is going to say, who is Dr. Ben Carson? And we are going to say, he's a Seventh-day Adventist. They're going to say, who are Seventh-day Adventists? And then the world, they don't have to go to any, they'll just go on the internet. And the gospel will be preached. Because you know that whoever is the president of the United States, they will revere that person. They will look at that person, look at their belief system. And the real belief system is going to be, what is your religion? Why do you say this and that? So get ready. Get ready for the final conflict that is coming upon this earth.
Amen.
Today's youth day, but all of us are youths. Once we are alive, the Bible says, John chapter 9, verse 4, write that down, use that as your theme. I must work the work of him who has sent me. The night cometh when no man can work. The night cometh when no man can work. Today you have an opportunity, just after Bible class or tomorrow, to go and share to people, starting with the commandments of God. And then you can preach the gospel thereafter. But repent, you can only repent if you have broken the commandments of God. So in love, we'll preach the gospel to the world. And I say, until we meet again, friends, keep strong in the Lord, because there is so much that the Lord requires of us to do. Keep strong. Keep your minds away from the distractions of the world.
Yes.
You know, the one of the most things that I hear Doug Batchelor when he made several of his presentations, if he has made over 500 presentations, probably about 100 really revolved around the cares of this life, because you know his mode of presentation and presenting the gospel is like from friend from a person to a friend, and he says the cares of this life, after all that he has seen, the cares of this life, and that's where we are, the Laodicean church. But there shall be a remnant of a remnant. There shall be a remnant of a remnant. Let us strive earnestly to be a part of that remnant, because many shall be deceived in the end.
Amen.
So, until next time, hold strong in the Lord.
Amen.
I really want to thank the Lord for sending and enabling Brother Wallace to bring us this timely message. You know, I sat here and I looked, even the children were quiet and listening. I've never heard it so quiet before. He's not a loud speaker, but everyone listened attentively. I thank the Lord for this message. It is very timely. It is present truth. It's something that we need to hear now. It is my prayer that it has gone into the hearts of each and every one of us, and that it will make us make haste to prepare for the soon coming of Jesus.
Amen.
We are going to stand now to sing our closing hymn, In Times Like These, number 593 in our hymnal. Let us stand. Yeah. heads in prayer. Father, eternal Father and O God, we thank you today for this time spent in your courts and in your presence. The fellowship was great. We thank you, dear Father, for your words. Words of life, of love, of warning. We pray, dear Father, that they will find good ground in our hearts, that they will stir us, that they will awaken us, that they will cause us to see and to understand that the time is now, that we need to be ready. There's hardly any time to speak about getting ready. The time is now to be ready. Father, send your Holy Spirit in our hearts and in our lives. May he counteract the influences of the evil one, so that we will be conquerors, so that we will receive from you the blessing of eternal life. We pray in a special way for our children and our young people who are facing what they know not. As older folks, we can see a little further than they, because we knew when things were different. But they have been born and are growing up in a world that is fully corrupt, and they don't understand. We pray in a very special way that your Holy Spirit will abound in their hearts. Your holy angels will watch over them and protect them. The influence of your scriptures, your words will dwell in their hearts, and that they will be saved from eternal destruction. We pray for Tony and others who will be going off to school to study. Help them to understand the true meaning of life. They do what they must to occupy the time until Jesus comes. But the real crux of the matter, the thing that matters most, is that they will prepare themselves to meet Jesus when he comes. Amen. That they will be graduated from this world into everlasting life. Yes. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen.